बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम डियर स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू द नूर स्कूल कॉलेज, नूर स्कूल एंड कॉलेज मानसेरा, फॉर द ऑनलाइन क्लास ऑफ फिज़िक्स। आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम यू ऑल टू द ऑनलाइन क्लासेस ऑफ फिज़िक्स ग्रेड 11। डियर स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द टर्मिनल वेलोसिटी। दिस इज़ आवर टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन टुडे, बट बिफोर गोइंग टू दिस टॉपिक आई वुड लाइक टू हैव अ वेरी क्विक रिव्यू ऑन the previous topics as the linkage. Dear students, we know that in chapter number 6 we considered the fluid dynamics. We know that fluid dynamics is the branch of physics in which we study about the properties of fluid while that fluid is in motion. The fluids in motion is called fluid dynamics. We discussed the four basic states of matter. We know that there are four states of matter: solids, liquids, gases and plasma. We define solid, liquid, gas and plasma, but our main concern is the liquid. Liquid is also called fluid. Fluid is a substance that can flow like water. There is weak atomic bond in the between the atoms or molecules of a fluid. It can have any shape. It is incompressible. The examples of fluids are water, milk, oil, tea, syrup and cold drinks. And we discussed some properties of the fluids, that the main and most important property of the fluids is the viscosity. Viscosity is called gaadapan in Urdu. Viscosity is in fact the resistance to the motion of an object through liquid. Whenever an object is moving through liquid, that liquid opposes the flow of that object, or the it opposes the movement or motion of that object. The symbol of viscosity is eta and its unit is pascal second or newton per meter square times second, or newton second by meter square. Dear student, this was the concept of viscosity. Now we come across the topic fluid dynamics. This is the study of motion. Dynamics means the study of motion as far as the liquids or fluids are concerned. So we defined fluid dynamics as study of liquids in dynamic state or in the state of motion. Fluids exert pressure and force, and fluids contain layers. There are two types of fluid flow: turbulent flow and streamline. In turbulent flow, there is irregular motion of the individual atoms or molecules, while in streamline flow there is a regular one directional motion of the fluid. And we discussed that heavy cold gases also behave like fluids. The examples of heavy gases are carbon dioxide, ethane, methane and liquid nitrogen, like this. Okay, now after that we discussed an important topic, Stokes' law. The name of this scientist was George Gabriel Stokes. He described a relation between resistive force of the fluid, which is also called drag force, the viscosity of the fluid, eta, the radius of the spherical object, r, and the speed of spherical object, v, velocity. This is the Stokes' law, is the relation between these four objects. We can write it as force is directly proportional to viscosity. The greater the viscosity, the greater is the resistive force. The greater is the radius, the greater is the resistive force. The greater is the velocity, the greater is the resistive force. So F, or drag force, is directly proportional to the viscosity, radius and velocity. Consider this figure. You have a container in which there is some fluid or liquid. For example, it is water, and water is made of these small dots, which are shown here as molecules. Consider a drop, consider a spherical object which is dropped into this liquid, and the weight of this drop is downward, mg. We know that when this object will go down, these molecules or atoms will strike with the surface of this sphere. That will provide an upthrust force. This upthrust force is called drag force. दिस वॉज द मैथमेटिकल फॉर्म ऑफ स्टोक्स लॉ. एफ इज़ डायरेक्टली प्रोपोर्शनल टू ईटा आर वी, वियर ईटा इज़ द विस्कोसिटी, आर इज़ द रेडियस, वी इज़ द वेलोसिटी. रिमूविंग द साइन ऑफ प्रोपोर्शनैलिटी वी यूज साइन ऑफ इक्वेलिटी एंड ए कॉन्स्टेंट. सो द कॉन्स्टेंट हेयर इज 6 pi. So F is equal to 6 pi eta r V, and there are some limitations of the Stokes law. Stokes law is valid for solids and spherical objects. If you have object like this shape, the Stokes law is not applicable, because Stokes law is applicable only for spherical object, and this law is valid for homogeneous liquid. This is not applicable on the mixture of liquid. This is the liquid which is absolutely pure. This law is valid for that one. Okay, dear students, these were the basic concepts. Now we are moving towards our main topic, terminal velocity. What do we mean by terminal velocity? Look at the definition of terminal velocity. The maximum constant velocity. Two things. One, constant velocity. Constant velocity means the velocity does not change, its value will remain same. That is why it is constant velocity or constant speed. And this velocity is the maximum value, the maximum velocity, achievable velocity. The maximum constant velocity achieved by a spherical object when its weight becomes equal to its drag force through a fluid. In simple words, we can say that whenever a spherical object falls through a fluid, there are two forces acting on that object. One is its weight, and the second one is the drag force. We also call it, according to Stokes' law, the force which is used in the formula of Stokes' law, that is called drag force. When the weight and drag force of the object become equal, then the object gets maximum constant velocity. This is called terminal velocity. Now, as far as the derivation is concerned, first of all, I would like to tell you some figure. Consider you have a glass of water, or some test tube, or some beaker, or some pot. Here is the level of the liquid. For example, a liquid is filled in this glass or this jar or this pot, whatever, whatsoever. Consider a sphere. If you drop the sphere, the weight of the sphere will be downward. And as we know that when this sphere will go down, these dots that are shown here, these are the molecules of the fluid. These molecules will provide an up thrust force, which is called drag force, FD. So when this sphere is moving through the liquid, two forces are acting on this object, this sphere. One is its weight, MG, and one is the drag force. These two forces are equal in magnitude but opposite in direction. Now, using this concept, we can say that for the derivation of the terminal velocity, consider a spherical ball. This is the spherical ball which is falling through a fluid. These dots are the atoms or molecules of the fluids. This sphere is moving through the you can say that some liquid or fluid, while passing through the liquid, they have to collide with the atoms of molecules. Weight is downward. We know that the weight of the sphere is downward and drag force is upward. As these two forces are equal in magnitude but opposite in direction, so we can use the condition of equilibrium. In fact, the first condition of equilibrium. This condition of equilibrium states that net force on that object will be equal to the difference between the two forces, because two forces are in opposite direction. Weight is downward and drag force is upward. You can see that weight minus drag force is the net force. Getting my point? According to the first condition of equilibrium, net force will be equal to weight minus drag force. The minus sign is for the reason that drag force is acting upward in the opposite direction to the weight. The direction of these two forces are opposite. That is why we can have the negative sign between these two forces. Now we consider that the net force is zero because we are talking about equilibrium. In the state of equilibrium, the net force between these two given forces will be zero. There is no net force acting on the object. Because two forces are equal in magnitude, they are opposite in direction, so they cancel out each other. So we have net force is equal to zero. The formula of weight is mg. This is minus, and we know that what is the formula of drag force according to Stokes' law. It is 6 pi eta r v. Now if you shift this negative side over here at the left side, you will get this negative sign as positive. We get 6 pi eta r v is equal to mg. If you realize, I have written a small subscript t with the velocity. This velocity is called terminal velocity. Terminal velocity is represented vt. Okay, now find out the value of vt. You can see that 6 pi eta and r, all these four factors are being multiplied. If I shift them to the right, all they will be divided. So I will get vt, or terminal velocity, is equal to mg divided by 6 pi eta r. Let me call this equation number 1. Okay, this was the very first equation of terminal velocity. Now I am going to write this equation again as vt is equal to mg divided by 6 pi eta r. This was equation number 1. Now for m, I am going to have some mathematical game. We know that density is equal to mass per unit volume, and the symbol of density is this. This is called rho. Density rho is equal to mass per unit volume. I can find out the value of mass, so cross multiply volume with the density. I will get mass is equal to rho into volume. Can you see it? Volume is multiplied with rho. Rho v, this will be the mass. Mass will be equal to rho into volume. So m mass, this is equal to, this is the density of the object, rho, and volume. As far as the spherical object is concerned, the volume of the spherical object is 4 by 3 pi r cube. This is the value of the volume. So put the value of the volume right here. I get m is equal to rho, and volume of the sphere is 4 by 3 pi r cube. Okay, let me call this equation number 2. I can put equation number 2 in equation number 1. Put the value of m from equation number 2 in equation number 1. So I get vt is equal to rho. You can see that vt is equal to, this is m, and instead of m I can write rho 4 by 3 pi r cube into g. This was the g, gravitational constant, gravitational acceleration, and 1 over 6 pi eta r. This is the denominator portion of the equation. Getting my point? 6 pi eta r v. This can also be written as 1 over 6 pi eta r v with a multiplication. Okay, when we solve this portion of the equation, we get vt is equal to, look, this 3 is in denominator and 4 is in numerator. All the upper terms are multiplied. I get 4 pi r cube rho g. Clear? And in the denominator, I can write this 3 is in denominator, this 6 is in denominator. 3, 6 r 18. 18 pi eta and r. Clear? Okay. Now you can rearrange and you can calculate these equations like this. Pi is cancelled with pi. Pi can be cancelled with pi. This r will be cancelled with r cube, and 4 will be divided with 18. So I get 2 r square rho g divided by n pi, where rho is this density, rho is the object's density, g is the gravitational acceleration, and eta is the viscosity of the fluid. Now as you can see that 2 rho g divided by n pi is a constant figure. So we can write, this implies that Vt is directly proportional to r square, the square of radius. What does it mean? It means that terminal velocity is directly proportional to the square of radius, and this is the radius of the sphere. Now, dear students, you have a question about this topic. If radius is doubled, what is the effect on terminal velocity? What you have to do is that this is, you can see that this is the radius, it is square of the radius, this is the terminal velocity. If you double the radius, this will become 2r whole square, the square of r and the square of 2. The square of 2 is 4. It means that when the radius is doubled, terminal velocity will become 4 times, because here you will use 2 for the double. You can see that here it is double. If radius is double, it means 2r whole square, the square of 2 will be 4. When radius is doubled, the terminal velocity becomes 4 times. Clear? Okay, this was the question. Now, dear students, one remaining thing is the example of paratrooper. What do you mean by paratrooper? Paratrooper is the soldier who jumps from a moving plane. This is called paratrooper. It is also called parachuter. Okay. When paratrooper jumps from the plane, his initial velocity is zero. He speeds up as he falls under the action of gravity until he opens his parachute. Okay, let me explain first here. This is the plane, fighter jet plane, F-16, JF Thunder, whatsoever. A paratrooper, a soldier, is jumping. As we know that when the soldier is jumping, the gravity will bring that soldier down. The initial vertical velocity is zero. As that person is falling down, its velocity increases. 1, 2 meter per second, 3 meter per second, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and so on. For example, when he achieves the velocity up to 30 meters per second, he opens his parachute. When he opens his parachute, the air is filled in the parachute. Initially, the weight of the object was downward. There was only one force acting on the object. Now, after opening the parachute, the air is filled in the parachute. You can see that. And this air will provide an upward force, which acts as the drag force. Getting my point? And that paratrooper comes into the condition of equilibrium, in which his drag force and weight become equal, so his velocity becomes constant. If, for example, he opens his parachute when his velocity was 30 meter per second, no longer his velocity will be increasing. It will remain same, 30 meter per second, 30 meter, 30 meter, 30 meter, 30 meter, 30 meter, up to the last landing point. Getting my point? Okay, I rephrase it again. When the paratrooper jumps from the plane, his initial velocity is zero. He is not opening his parachute right after jumping from the plane. So gravity pulls him down. His velocity increases from 0 to 1 meter per second, 2 meter per second, 3 meter per second, 4 meter, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and so on, up to 30. For example, this soldier is opening his parachute on 30 meter per second. The moment when he opens his parachute at this velocity, the velocity will become equal. 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, 30, up to the last landing point. इट मीन्स दैट इन दिस रीजन हिज वेलोसिटी इज कॉन्स्टेंट एंड फ्रॉम दिस रीजन टू दिस रीजन हिज वेलोसिटी इंक्रीजेज. गेटिंग माई पॉइंट? सो दिस वॉज द एग्जाम्पल ऑफ पैराट्रूपर. वेन पैराट्रूपर जम्प्स फ्रॉम प्लेन हिज इनिशियल वेलोसिटी इज जीरो. He speeds up as he falls until he opens his parachute. After opening the parachute, his velocity becomes constant. This maximum constant velocity is his terminal velocity. Dear students, I hope that you might have understood the basic concepts of terminal velocity. So please do your research on it, make your notes and go through the topic. And I hope that there will not be any confusion, any ambiguity of this topic. Thank you very much.